Hey, what up, everybody? This is Stevie Breach coming to you here with a DVD look at the triumph and tragedy of World Class Championship Wrestling, which was, of course, based out of Dallas, Texas. And one of the big things that I'm planning on doing with my WrestleMania 32 trip is that I believe on Saturday morning, waking up early and heading on out and checking out the former site of the Sportatorium. I know that the Sportatorium is not standing anymore. But I still want to see the memories of, you know, everything that went down there. And it's just sort of a, I don't know what, it's like a landmark for professional wrestling. It's just like, I don't know, man. Like, if I ever went to Detroit, I'd want to see where the Pontiac Silverdome stood or something like that. You know, I want to see where the life and blood and everything was spewed at the Von Erichs versus the Freebirds feud. You know, where Stone Cold Steve Austin trained to become a professional wrestler. And that's probably the one thing right off the bat of this triumph and tragedy of World Class Championship Wrestling. Why Stone Cold Steve Austin wasn't interviewed or you know, any classic footage put in there. Definitely, you know, they had Shawn Michaels on there and some other guys. But I don't know. I would have put Stone Cold Steve Austin, definitely one of the biggest stars. I honestly don't think he ever wrestled for World Class Championship Wrestling, but he did wrestle for the USWA. He was trained by Chris Adams, and I would have had him in there just to say something about the Sportatorium if I could have. But that's gonna be a fun part of the trip. But here we are, the Freebirds versus the Von Erichs, right there at the headline of this DVD. You've got you know, Buddy Roberts. You've got Terry Gordy, you got Michael P.S. Hayes, I call him Doc Hendricks still, and of course there you have David, Kevin, and Kerry, the three, you know, big stars of the Von Erichs. I don't know, maybe Mike isn't, you know, the most famous of them. Maybe Mike didn't really want to wrestle, and Fritz sort of forced him in there, but I don't know if it would have been, you know, that odd to have, you know, all four of the famous Von Erich brothers on the cover there for you. But we're going to take a look at this, the triumph and tragedy of World Class Championship Wrestling. It's the two-disc set. I want to think this came out like in 2005, maybe 2006, somewhere around that time. After Kevin Von Erich, the last surviving member of the Von Erich family, sold the video footage from World Class Championship Wrestling to Vince McMahon. Of course, then he would be a part of their Raw Homecoming, getting one of the biggest pops I ever seen. And you know, basically wanting me to find out why the Von Erichs are so popular. This has got a good long documentary. I'm sure I'll review that within the next couple of days. But then here we are starting. These are the bonus features, probably some interviews and things like that to show off their you know, television that they used to run back in the day. The matches, we'll start right over here. 2 out of 3 falls. We've got Duke. I don't even know who that is. Going up against Ricky Starr. American Heavyweight Championship. Fritz Von Erich Retirement Show. We've got Fritz Von Erich going up against King Kong Bundy in 1982. That would be before WrestleMania 2. So that's a big deal. Steel Cage Match for the World Heavyweight Championship. This would be from the Star Wars of Wrestling Show. Ric Flair going up against Kerry Von Erich. A very famous wrestling match which would start the Von Erich versus Freebird feud, basically with Michael P.S. Hayes being in the ring as a special. He wasn't really the referee because there was another referee in there. He was like the special enforcer inside of a steel cage match. Maybe he's there to make sure they're kicking enough ass. I'm not sure. But Hayes was trying to give Von Erich the win, and Von Erich didn't want to win that way. So basically he got pissed, and as he was just saying, forget it, I'm walking out of this match, I'm not going to be the enforcer no more. Kerry went over to punch him, and then Flair came and hit Kerry into Michael Hayes. Michael Hayes went flying out of the ring, turned around, and because Kerry was there, even though he just got kicked in the back, thought Kerry did it, slammed the cage right into Kerry Von Erich's head, and the war was off and running from there. Great match. It's on the WWE Network. If you haven't seen it, you go over and you check out the World Class Championship Vault, and you'll find it. It's the Christmas show. I think it's December 24th. It might even be December 25th from 1982. Then we have here Iceman going up again. Oh, Iceman with Kevin and David Von Erich going up against the Freebirds. We've got a hair versus hair match. Iceman going up against Buddy Roberts. That's a great freaking match, a great feud. Buddy Roberts, of course, loses his hair in that match. There, he would sort of go with the sort of gimmick that Kurt Angle did when he lost his hair in WWF, you know, wrestling with the sort of wrestling, you know, thing around it, and he would wear wigs and all sorts of things to try and cover up the fact that he lost that match. From there, we go to a six-man title match, David Von Erich Memorial. This would be Fritz, Mike, David, going up against the Fabulous Freebirds. Then we go over here to the David Von Erich Memorial Parade of Champions in 84. Gentleman Chris Adams and Sunshine going up against Gorgeous Garvin and Precious. The Great Kabuki against Kamala. Then we have the Fantastics against Midnight Express. We've got Chris Adams versus Kevin Von Erich. One Man Gang and Rick Rude going up against Bruiser Brody and The Missing Link. Then we got the third Cotton Bowl Extravaganza, Bruiser Brody against Abdullah the Butcher. Oh, wow, that finishes it off. That's still a good listing of matches right there. You know, World Class Championship Wrestling would run the Sportatorium, and then for big shows, they would run the Cotton Bowl as well as Cowboys Stadium. Discs, pretty much just like the cover. We flip it over, and we'll look at the back real fast. There's the announcer, the Sheik, Gino Hernandez. There's after winning the NWA World Heavyweight Championship, Kerry Von Erich and Fritz Von Erich. Freebirds versus the Von Erichs. You got Chris Adams and Sunshine going up against Jimmy Garvin and Precious. The Fantastics against the Midnight Express. I don't know, man. It's hard to put this over. I understand if you don't want to go back and watch a lot of 80s wrestling. But this is going to be the best 80s wrestling that you can probably find. It'd be fun if you watched this, you know, as the sort of weekly shows rolled out, on the WWE Network. But if not, just check out this documentary, check out these series of matches. The best, the triumph and tragedy of World Class Championship Wrestling. Hey, what up, everybody? This is Stevie Breach coming to you here today. This is going to be a DVD review on the triumph and tragedy of World Class Championship Wrestling. This is available on the WWE Network under the Beyond the Ring category, and this one is a mother. I mean, honestly, one of the biggest things that we have planned for WrestleMania weekend is to head just a couple miles from where our hotel is and check out the lot, which once held the Sportatorium, which was the home base of World Class Championship Wrestling. Definitely one of the biggest wrestling promotions at one point, was one of the hottest wrestling promotions in all of the country. Of course, right here on the cover of the World Class Championship Wrestling, you've got the Freebirds against the Von Erichs, one of the hottest feuds that they've ever seen in the history of wrestling. I believe it was number 5 on the top 25 WWE Rivalries DVD that came out a few years ago. And there's no other way to start talking about World Class Championship Wrestling other than talking about Fritz Von Erich, who was the father of the Von Erich family, who was the leader of World Class Championship Wrestling. He was the Vince McMahon of this company, which was based out of Dallas, Texas. And Fritz was a wrestler that sort of bounced around from place to place. He was a popular wrestler. He sort of had this sort of German wrestler gimmick that, you know, he was always looked at it as he was the heel, and he had the Iron Claw, which was his finisher. And what the plan was for him and his wife was they were going to move to Dallas, and they were basically going to finish up his wrestling career, and he was going to open a bakery. But what ended up happening was, you know, he caught fire there in Dallas and worked his way up to the top of the promotion, and ended up being the guy in charge. And from there, he would go on to have 5 sons that all ended up going into the wrestling business. He ended up having 6 sons, and what the sad thing about it is that the Von Erich family sort of has this curse, or maybe this sort of tragedy that has lingered over his family almost his whole entire life. He had one son
who died at the age of 6 when he was still living in New York before he had even moved to Dallas. That was a sad thing where an electrical wire came loose and shocked him, and then he fell into a puddle in which he drowned. From there, we had Kevin Von Erich, the Golden Warrior, who was the oldest of the sons. Most people would know about him, even if you've only watched WWE. If you go back and watch that Raw Homecoming show back in the day, this is the first time that I ever really figured out anything about the Von Erichs, and it was one of the reasons why I sort of got into it. Kevin Von Erich was in the crowd, and he was announced, and then he ended up going out and attacking Rob Conway, which had the sort of the Legends gimmick. And his pop, for just being a guy in the crowd, is the largest pop that I've ever heard for anybody that's more than likely not on the WWE roster, or nobody that's ever wrestled for WWE. This is when I first started to get into, trying to figure out about the Von Erich family and about World Class Championship Wrestling. From there was David Von Erich, who was the Yellow Rose. He was probably the best wrestler of the Von Erich group. He had the big time matches where he would wrestle against Harley Race, where he would wrestle against Ric Flair. He would come to his death in 1984. And then from there we go to Kerry Von Erich, who was probably the most famous. He was probably the best looking. He was probably the most with the most charisma, the most character to him. He was the modern day warrior. He was the one Von Erich that went on to win the NWA world title. At one point, Fritz Von Erich said that all of his sons would go on to become, world champions. What you might know about Kerry Von Erich is that he wrestled in WWF as the Texas Tornado, becoming an Intercontinental Champion. His daughter was Lacey Von Erich, who wrestled in TNA. He also was involved in a motorcycle accident, and he only had a partial part of his foot. It's debated whether if he didn't have his whole foot or if he didn't have a part of his foot, but still, he wrestled at the tail end of his career with only part of his foot, and nobody really knew about it. From there was Mike Von Erich, who basically really didn't want to get into the wrestling business. He more wanted to be a cameraman or sort of behind the scenes sort of deal. And it's always been said that Fritz Von Erich pushed him into the wrestling business after the death of David Von Erich, almost to the point just so they could have, a three-man team to have six-man tags. He got into wrestling. Once he finally got into it, he had some success. During a tour of Israel, he ended up coming down with an injury. Once he was flown back, he had to have surgery. And during the surgery, bacteria in his body caused him to have toxic shock syndrome. And then basically he was pushed back by Fritz to get back into wrestling sooner than he should have. And then shortly after his retirement, because his body breaking down for not having enough time after the injury, he committed suicide in 1987. From there, the last Von Erich would be Chris Von Erich, who just never really grew into the bodies of the other three Von Erichs. He was only at 5'4", but he loved the wrestling business as much as anybody, and it almost crushed him to the point where he couldn't get into wrestling. He tried managing, he tried just being like a wrestler that would wrestle in like tag team matches with his brothers, where his brothers would carry him, but it just never really worked out to the point where he was supposed to. And in 1991, he committed suicide as well. There was a short point when Fritz Von Erich came up with an idea of adding another Von Erich. Lance Von Erich basically came in, and it was just sort of a big wrestling angle. But because of the fact that the Von Erichs were good guys, and the Von Erichs are always sort of told the truth and did what they were supposed to, even though that they had a lot of dark side to them in their real personal life, the fans sort of didn't like this idea. Fritz picked a local hometown hero who was a high school athlete. People knew who he was. They knew he wasn't a Von Erich. And I don't know. This is a weird time in wrestling. This would have to be like 1985, 1986 is when this happens. And they sort of needed him because they wanted to be able to have more Von Erichs to work these matches, because they didn't want, to burn out Kerry Von Erich or Kevin Von Erich from having to work match after match and then have to do double shows and things like that. And it just got to the point where it was embarrassing, and actually Fritz Von Erich had to go on television and admit that Lance wasn't an Von Erich, and he was thrown out of the World Class Championship Wrestling. They almost seemed like they put the blame on Lance, and they basically said that his name would never be spoken on World Class Championship Wrestling again. Great, great stuff. I mean, the reason why World Class Championship Wrestling is famous today is because of the fact of basically the Von Erichs versus the Freebirds feud. The Von Erichs were always on top because of the fact that Fritz could trust them, that they weren't going to go anywhere else because they were his sons, they were his blood. And the Freebirds were the perfect team to come in and feud against them. It just was some of the best stuff that you could see in professional wrestling. It definitely is one of the biggest feuds of all time. You know, they had really had great people supporting World Class Championship Wrestling. You had Jimmy Garvin with Sunshine and Precious. You had the Iceman. You had Chris Adams. You had the Missing Link. They had great characters all around them, you know, as well as, you know, bringing in like guys like Gino Hernandez, one of the greatest heels of all time. You know, he really was wrestling. I mean, he was great at promos. He was great in the ring. He could wrestle. He could bump. And he just was one of the best guys that you could bring in. But basically, after the death of David Von Erich, they had Ric Flair go up against Kerry Von Erich. And this was going to be a match at Texas Stadium with 50,000 fans there. You know, Kerry Von Erich would beat Ric Flair, but he would become the NWA World Heavyweight Champion. But then after only 17 days, Kerry Von Erich lost the title back to Ric Flair. They talked about on the DVD was one of the reasons why the NWA ended up taking the title off Kerry Von Erich was they didn't really believe in the guy. They didn't think that he was going to be able to make every town because he was a known drug user. He was a guy that basically would blow off towns like they were no big deal. And the NWA championship was never really taken as a joke. And they didn't really want it where, you know, people were thinking that they were going to get an NWA championship main event and they weren't going to be able to deliver just because Terry didn't feel like going to the town. Kerry would lose the championship after only 17 days in a match over in Tokyo, and World Class Championship Wrestling tried to cover up for the fact, saying that Ric Flair cheated in the match. The referee was only a sumo referee, and he didn't understand the rules of professional wrestling. You know, also at this time, we have in 1984, we've got the Freebirds leaving World Class Championship Wrestling. Jimmy Garvin and Precious would leave to go to the AWA. They would sort of make new stars by promoting Chris Adams and Gino Hernandez up to the main event. They would continue to sort of build steam in 1985. Fritz would take World Class Championship Wrestling on a world tour, heading over to Israel because of Coach Landry. Would go there on a vacation, and during the vacation, he came back just basically telling Fritz that, you know, over in Israel, people know who you guys are, and he just basically thought there was no other wrestling going on over there, and that would be a great chance for them to make money. In 1986, World Class Championship Wrestling was, you know, rocked once again with the death of Gino Hernandez, which a lot of people sort of result to being involved in the drug trade. Gino Hernandez was found with cocaine in his stomach, and the death was ruled an overdose. I know that's one of the big things that's coming up with the Doc Hendricks future episode of Legends with JBL. That was one of the things that tied in on the commercial, basically saying that you don't think that Gino Hernandez's death you know, was an overdose, and he says basically, I didn't say that, you said that. Basically just trying to get people thinking. But you know, the cocaine was found in Gino's stomach, which is a little bit weird for an overdose. You don't normally eat or drink cocaine. You know, some people might think that it might be a drug dealer or some sort of a another wrestler. I've heard lots of different theories over what people sort of think it went down. After 86, the World Class Championship Wrestling was withdrawal from the NWA. Some people say it's because they wouldn't get behind Kerry Von Erich and make him the world champion as well. The Von Erichs seemed to think that it was because they thought that the wrestling was moving in a more fast pace, and people didn't want to see the slower style of the NWA, so that was the one reason why they sort of covered everything up. The Freebirds would try to come back and try to, you know, get the boom period of the Freebirds versus the Von Erichs from, you know, around the 84 era. You know, around this time, Rick Rude would debut. They would put the world championship on Black Bart. Kerry Von Erich would be involved in a motorcycle accident where basically his foot would get trapped underneath the car. And when they had to, you know, put the foot back together, Kerry Von Erich in a a moment in a hospital room, you know, trying to get more painkillers, would get up out of bed and he would crush his foot yet once again to the point where doctors weren't going to be able to fix the 15-hour surgery that they just went able to went through, so they were forced to amputate part of the foot. From there, the World Class Championship Wrestling would sort of have their last ditch effort to try and get back on the map. In 1988, they would come together with the AWA as well as the USWA. That would be like the Minnesota up north and Memphis territories coming together to have Super Class 3, which would be headlined by Jerry the King Lawler going up against Kerry Von Erich. The match is really good, and Lawler says it's always one of the matches that people talk to him the most about and have the most memories of. But, you know, Kerry Von Erich had a great match that day, but people say that he wasn't under the best care. Maybe that's the best way to put it. Kerry Von Erich would have a blade put on his finger, and before the match would happen, would forget about it and go to scratch his arm, basically, you know, cutting his arm open before the match would even start. Lawler said they had to cover for it, basically cleaning the arm off as fast as they could, and then once they had the ring introductions, immediately going and banging Kerry's arm up against the turnbuckle, that way giving it a reason, thinking that maybe it would have got cut when it went on the turnbuckle. But from there, the match would be a bloody mess, with Kerry Von Erich finally strapping the claw down on top of Jerry Lawler, but because the referee thought that there was too much blood getting into the eyes of Kerry Von Erich, threw the match out, basically saying that Jerry Lawler would be the winner, and he would keep his championship. Shortly after Super Clash 3, Fritz Von Erich sold 60% of the World Class Championship Wrestling to Jerry Jarrett, who would rename it the USWA, and that was basically it. You know, at the end of this, a few years later, Fritz Von Erich would die in 1997. Then we have David Von Erich, who died in 84, followed by Mike in 87, Chris Von Erich in 1991. And then, you know, in 1986, after, you know, not being able to put his family back together and about to go to jail for drug charges, Kerry Von Erich would end himself as well. And it's just a sad thing to sort of see this sort of tragedy hang over a great company like USWA and all the good things that they, USWA, World Class Championship Wrestling, and all the great things that went down in this company. This is a great DVD. Check it out on the WWE Network or pick up the DVD itself. It's loaded with extras and lots of great matches.